Welcome back. In this video, I want to talk about some elements regarding memory management that are specific in C++. First, I would like to describe the format of static variables. You should remember static in Java. Then I would like to talk about constructors and destructors. You could remember the concept of constructor in Java. Now we have also destructors. And finally, I want to review new and delete. That will replace the instruction malloc and free that we use in C. Let's see. We can use the keyword static to create a static variable. The static variables are going to be shared by all the objects from a class, just like in Java. An important difference is that static variables in C++ must be explicitly defined outside of the class. So in order to define a static variable counter A inside of the class foo, you create the variable inside of the class and you define the variable also outside. When you do that outside, you need to put before the name of the variable, the name of the class, and the scope resolution operator in the middle. Notice that having the name of the class and the scope resolution operator is the only thing that help us to identify that this one is a static variable and not a global variable like counter. Counter is a global variable because it's outside of the class, outside of any method, and do not have the scope resolution operator in any place. In order to use the static variable, like here, we use the name of the variable and the name of the class, but in the middle, we put the scope resolution operator. This is different than what you do in Java, because in Java, you put the name of the class, the dot, and the name of the static variable. Here, static variables use the scope resolution operator instead of the dot. You are familiar with constructors. These methods that have the same name of the class and that are called each time that you create a new object. They exist in Java and they are going to exist also in C++. A new concept that I would like to present is destructors. These are methods that also have the same name of the class, but with a tilde at the beginning. So you're going to have tilde and then the name of the class. And those methods are going to be called automatically when the object is removed from the memory. In Java, if you remember, you have this feature of garbage collection. Therefore, you don't worry about removing objects from the memory. However, in C++, we do not have a garbage collector because we do not use an interpreter, because we do not have a virtual machine. Therefore, you are responsible for removing your objects from the memory when you do not need the objects anymore. And when that happens, this method, the destructor, is going to be called. Let me show you an example. This is the class cube, and it has two constructors, one without parameters, one with one parameter, and it has a destructor. Notice that the two constructors have the same name of the class, and the destructor has the name of the class and the tilde as a prefix. In the body of the methods, notice that the methods are being defined outside of the class. Therefore, we have here the name of the method and the name of the class, and in the middle, the scope resolution operator. For the destructor, the name includes the tilde at the beginning. The body of the three methods is the same. The only thing that I am doing here is to print a message. Then, inside of the main, I am creating two objects. One using the constructor that receives an integer, and a second one using the constructor that do not have parameters. Notice that when you want to use the constructor without parameters, you do not need to put the parentheses. So my Q2 is calling the constructor without parameter, the default constructor, and my Q1 is calling the constructor that receives an integer as a parameter. In this case, 500 is going to be the value used as a parameter. And that's it. There is nothing else in the main method. When you run this program, this is going to be the output. The first constructor that is being called is the constructor to receive an int as a parameter. That is the message that I am printing here. The second thing that is happening is that the constructor without parameter is being called. This message is printed here. And if you notice, the destructor is being called twice, automatically. Why? Because we have two objects from the class Q, and when the main method finishes, before it is calling the destructor for the two objects that we create as local variables. So the destructors are called automatically before the objects disappear from the memory. In this case, they are deleted automatically when main ends. But before that happens, the destructors are called. And because the destructor is printing this message, destructor, we saw that message twice, one time for each object. There are four ways to call the destructor of a class. First, if you create an object as a local variable, that means inside of the curly bracket of any method, when the method returns, the destructor is going to be called for that object. Second, if you create objects as a global variables or static variables, the destructor is going to be called when the program ends, that is, when the main method finishes. Third, you can call the destructor explicitly because it's a method. Therefore, you can call that method in the same way that you call others with its name. Finally, destructors are called if you use delete, and we're going to talk about delete next. It is important to have in mind how the memory is organized when a program is executed. When you run a program, you have two spaces in the memory that you can use for your data. The first one is the stack. The stack is a small space. In the stack, you store global variables, static variables, and for each method, when you execute the method, you're going to have this space in which the local variables are going to be stored. Everything that you put in the stack is going to be automatically removed from the memory when the method finishes or when the program ends. In Java, every time that you create an object or an array, both the object and the array were not stored in the stack. Again, because the stack is small, arrays and objects were stored in the heap. So objects and arrays were put in the heap by the Java virtual machine. And what you have as a local variable or global variable or a static variable for them, arrays and objects, was a reference. So what you store in the stack was the address in the heap of those elements, objects and arrays. Moreover, the Java virtual machine keep the heap clean using the garbage collector. C and C++ give you the freedom to choose in which place do you want to put arrays and objects. You can put objects and arrays in the stack or in the heap. It is your choice. The issue is that whatever you put in the heap, you are responsible for removing that memory, for cleaning the heap. And this is important. You are responsible for cleaning the heap because you do not have in C and C++ the garbage collector that you had in Java. You can create objects with this instruction. These objects are going to be stored in the stack. Therefore, they are going to be automatically removed from the memory, in this case, when the main method finishes. You do not need to do anything. If you want to store an object in the heap, then you need a pointer. So you can create a pointer like this. But the pointer is just a variable that is going to store the address of the object. That pointer is going to be in the stack. Then you need to reserve memory for the object. And you do that with the keyword new. Yes, new, like in Java. This instruction new is going to create an object in the heap, and it's going to put the address of that object in the variable myq, in this case, that is in the stack. This variable myq is going to be removed from the memory when the program ends, but that variable has only the address of the object. If you do not remove the object, that object is going to be in the heap forever, and you do not want that. So before the program ends, and therefore before the variable myq is removed, you need to eliminate the object that you create from the heap. And we can do that with the instruction delete. Delete is the opposite of new. New reserve memory for the object. Delete is going to release that memory. It's going to clean the space. Delete is the action that the garbage collector do automatically in Java. But here you need to do that with this instruction, delete. So if you want the object in the heap, you need a pointer. You need to do a new instruction to create the object, and you are responsible for the cleaning of the heap doing a delete for that memory that you reserve. If you do not reserve memory in the heap, like here, when you create the object directly in the stack, you do not need a delete operation for that object, because again, that one is in the stack and the cleaning of the stack is automatic. Now, new and delete have a relationship with constructors and destructors. You know that new basically call a constructor when you use new with objects. And as we mentioned before, delete is going to call the destructor of a class when you apply the delete operation to an object. So this is the example that we reviewed before. We have two objects, my Q1 and my Q2. They are in the stack, and the destructor for them is going to be called when the main method finishes, because in that moment they are removed from the stack. Now we have this pointer, my Q3. With a pointer, we can use the instruction new. So this line is creating a new object, but in the heap. The pointer with the address of the object is in the stack, but the data, the object itself, is in the heap. For this object, we need to apply a delete instruction. We need to clean whatever we put in the heap. So this new instruction needs this delete instruction. Now, let's review the class. Inside of the class, we have this variable here that is a pointer, buffer. And if we notice here in one of the constructors, what we do with that pointer buffer is to apply a new instruction. Notice that you can apply new with a primitive data type like int, and that means that this array of integers is going to be created in the heap, and the address is going to be stored inside of this object. And remember, the object is in the heap also. If we create an object or an array in one of the constructors, it's our responsibility to clean that space using a delete operation. And we can put that delete operation in the destructor. So constructor can do new operations, and destructors are going to do delete operations. So for each new instruction that you put in a constructor, you need to put a delete instruction in the destructor. The delete instruction in main is going to call the destructor of the class Q, because my Q3 is an object from the class Q. Then, inside of the destructor of Q, you call delete again, but now for buffer. And buffer is a variable in the class Q, a pointer. And what you are doing there is to clean the memory of the array pointed by buffer. And then, when you go back to the main, the delete instruction in main is going to clean the memory that the object is using. And that includes the variables qsize, front, rear, and so on. Then the program is going to end, and the memory for my Q1 and my Q2 is going to be released from the stack. One last thing is to review what happened with arrays of objects. Let's see. When we use new to create an array, and that array is an array of objects, new is going to call the constructor of the class for each of the objects in the array. So in this case, if we create an array with four objects, the constructor of the class is called four times, one for each object, automatically. When you call delete for an array, and you know that because you put the square brackets after the delete keyword, if the array is an array of objects, delete is going to be called one time per each object in the array. So here, when you do the delete of the array P, because size of P is 4, that delete is going to be called 4 times, one time for each object. So when we work with array of objects, new is called as many times as the size of the array, and delete is also called as many times as the size of the array, like in this example. Before continuing with the next video, I will recommend you to play with this source code and be sure that you understand every single line. As you notice, there is a pointer for the array, there is another pointer that is being used inside of the for loop. We are printing the address of the objects in the array and the values of each of the variables inside of each object, as well as the calls to constructor and destructors. So, review this and see you in the next video.